I am recording now. We're based in Rock Hill, Connecticut. We got just under 30,000 square feet. That's manufacturing. It's administrative. Tech support is scattered throughout the country. We also have an office in Portugal that oversees Europe, Africa, Middle East, and Asia. And they help our dealers over there with tech support, sales, marketing. So what we're going to be showcasing today in some of our innovations is the DTG, the direct-to-garment, right? We're going to be printing LED inks onto some t-shirts. We're going to be printing cylindrically. We have a cylindrical attachment so we can print bottles. There's even a conical adapter so we can print to pint glasses and, you know, stuff that's not a straight wall that needs to be lifted up a little. These machines also can print ADA Braille signage, like our bigger machines, and they can also print textured as well. So these machines are super versatile, you know, and they offer a lot for what they can do, right? So you can do garments, ADA, textured, bottles, anything that customers might bring to you into your shop. You basically have the option of saying, yeah, I can do that. So it's the 1800 S series today. The biggest difference is the S15, which is the picture here, is our 6-inch version, which means it has 6 inches of Z axis. So anything 6 inches and below you can print to. And then the S35, which you'll see in the video, is our 15-inch version. 15 inches is the highest Z-axis height in the industry that I know of. You mean you can print the 64-ounce and 128-ounce Yeti tumblers, you know, the very large tumblers. You can print to urns and stuff like that. Also, we have customers that print to basketballs. We have customers that print to custom crates that get filled with, you know, promotional items, and then you can open the crates up, but he prints to the side of them with corporate logos and names and stuff like that. We do use Epson DX heads in these with 8 channels. They are fantastic for resolution. They offer 1440 resolution, which is photographic quality. I mean, any Epson printer's known for being a great photographic printer. So your quality of the print in this is really good. It does use an air-cooled lamp on the machine, just one, and it has a laser print height adjustment. So you just put it on the material and press the LED button down and it sees the material, it basically stops. Now, the only time that may come into call is if you're doing acrylic or glass and the beam shoots through the glass or the acrylic, in which case we just tape the sides. And it does come, again, the versatility of it is that it is available with the ADA software, the textured software. You can buy a vacuum table for it if you're printing to really thin material that likes to curl when printed. There's a cylindrical attachment for the easy spill. We also have platens available for DTG printing, so you can do t-shirts and, you know, sweatshirts and other things like that. And here are just some photos of the printers, right? It's printing cylindrical. We're going to showcase that to you really soon. You can switch between all these different types of things relatively quickly and easily. The cylindrical attachment actually only takes about 5 minutes to put on and off. And the first time you put it on, you do all your alignments, lock them in. And after that, it's very minimal adjustment. So basically, the easy seal takes about 5 minutes. The t-shirt platen, again, just goes onto the table. Doesn't take any time at all. The vacuum table, you would take off your silicone tacky mat and place the vacuum table into the bushings on the steel sheet, the steel table. So all this stuff is very easy to switch between. Doesn't take much time and is relatively clean, right? There's not much there that you have to do. So printing to toys, printing to mugs, printing garments. And again, our software does come with all the ADA information, right? So raised, tactile, and Braille printing in single pass. It meets ADA guidelines for compliance, and it also allows for maximum creativity for designers, right? You can add logos, you can add graphics, you can change the color of everything on it. As long as you meet those compliances, you're pretty much fine. The ADA software does come with the grade 1, 2 and California grade Braille, and does have all the proper spacing, alignments, preloaded templates for bathrooms and stuff like that, so you don't have to recreate them. So there's a lot of built-in compliance that you don't really necessarily have to worry about. You know, spacing of the Braille dots, each individual Braille dot, that's all done. Spacing of the tactile, that's all done. And it allows you to change, you know, font and change the language as well. And if something goes wrong, like if you decide to change your font and go outside of compliance, it's going to tell you. It's going to say, hey, you're changing something. This is going to make your sign not compliant. Do you want to continue? And you have to say, yeah, I do. Like, I know I'm making a non-compliant sign. It's okay. But that's just there so that you can basically say, you know, protect yourself a little bit and not make something that's outside of compliance. So the textured software allows you to call out different, basically different areas of the print and say, I want to have this be textured more than this. And it allows you to basically add dimension to different parts of the sign. So you can, if think of like a landscape painting, you know, you could make the foreground much higher texture. And then as you move forward, less and less texture because it's further away. If you wanted to print out a sign and you have a corporate logo in a corner and you want the corporate logo to be a standout piece, right? You could do the texture of just the corporate logo. So when people see it, their eye is drawn to the sign and then to the corporate logo. And we do have badge and array functions in the software as well with a built-in ink cost calculator. So you can run a sign before you print it and know how much that's going to cost you. So since we're doing so many demos, I'm trying to get through that pretty quick so we can go over to Steve in Connecticut, and he is going to show us basically what he's doing here.
Okay, so basically we're going to do four different applications. As you see now, I have the EasyCell, the bottle cylindrical device, printing a bottle. That's going to take about 3 minutes, 45 seconds to do. Oh, a bottle with a large logo and our logo on it. The ink cost, I think, Adam, it was about, it's, I think I just sent it to you, but we'll get it later.
It's the ink cost on this bottle is going to be about 25 cents.
25 cents. Oh, yeah, sorry, 25 cents. So there's obviously different bottle styles you could print on. As you said, cylindrical bottles we have, or cups, I should say. So we have, yeah, you know, the cylindrical all the way around.
Yeah. So
for Bopcha right there.
Yeah. So the bottles, that the clear one he just showed you, the Minnesota one, the one he's about to show you, these are all straight wall bottles, right? Yep. They're barrel shaped. That white one and this one he's showing you would be considered conical shaped because they have a smaller base than the top, right? So when we print these, we actually have a conical adapter that helps lift up the butt or the bottom of the bottle so that you're printing to a flat area instead of something that would be at an angle.
Correct. So basically all you do in the software is you create your, I'll show you the software here.
Yep. And this is our 15 inch version. You can see how tall it is. So you have 15 inches, 0 to 15 to print to. And again, that's good for, you know, tall items. And we find a lot of people who purchase those machines are people who want to basically print to something either tall, or they don't want their customers going somewhere else. So they buy that machine saying, okay, if someone ever comes to me with something tall, I can say, yes, I can print that instead of being limited to 6 inches.
Yeah, so basically you design your logo, you put your logo in there, import it. And then you want to rotate it 90 degrees because you're actually printing as the table moves forward, it rotates those that cylindrical device and rotates the bottle. So what I usually do is either make the blank size the size of the bottle, or just make myself an outline and make it the diameter and the height. So the height is about 5.5. And you're going to know if it's a straight walled bottle, you're going to know the print area on it if you do it this way. And then if you just measure it all the way around, it's going to be about 7. So you have all that. If you want to do a full wrap, obviously you would do the design from those measurements there. So
yes. Yeah. So I was going to say, so basically you got to know the height of the bottle and then the circumference around the bottle if you're going to do a full wrap. Yep. Otherwise you just kind of need to know the diameter of it. Make sure you're just not printing too big. But Steve, can you throw one of those bottles, straight wall bottles, onto the Easy Seal real quick?
Sure.
And then, because the bottle's 90 degrees, right, on the table, it's across the table. So that's why we have to, in the software, rotate it 90 degrees. Otherwise, if we printed it, it would print the other way.
Yeah.
Yeah. So the bottle sits there like that. And so basically, you're printing sideways.
Yeah.
And then as the table moves forward and backwards, it rotates the rollers, which rotates the bottle.
And then when you send it to your Easy Seal queue, it actually, the margins and everything all preset for you. So, and we have print modes that accommodate the queue. So it's pretty simple. You set up your artwork in the front end, send it to the queue, and you choose your print mode accordingly. Either if you're printing on clear, obviously you'd print a white color print mode. We do have a textured print mode as well for the bottles. You could see the textured clear here. And there's also...
Oh, sorry, I was going to say, for those of you who don't know, he is saying white color print mode. It just means that we're putting down white first and then color.
Thanks, Adam.
Yeah.
And then here's a more, a better example of the actual texture on the... on the bottle there. That's an aluminum bottle. So there's several different bottles. We actually, the Yeti cups work pretty well because they're powder coated. And they actually work pretty well through the dishwasher. So yeah, so that's your first application there.
Yep, and that cylindrical device can come right off. There's basically two bolts that you screw down. So if you were like, okay, I'm gonna print a dozen bottles for, you know, the local school's basketball team, you could then just undo the screws, pull the Easy Seal off, and then you could, you know, go back to printing ADA textured or flat graphics, or you could be printing promotional items or whatever. So it is relatively quick. There's no real change in the software for you either. So you don't have to, you know, go in the software and change stuff around there. It's literally just taking that off and then putting it back on. We have a question here of if the Easy Seal is available for the 1800Z, which is the older generation before the S. And yes, it is. It does work on the 1800Z. It's actually the exact same. There's no difference. You do get a new software module with it, because when we're printing, we actually have to limit the number of nozzles that print, because it is, you know, round. We don't want to be printing too far away from the surface of the bottle. And because of that, you know, it would just basically cause overspray. So we really bring it and limit it down. And then another question here, are the bottles treated with a wipe? Great question, right? Because you're going to touch them, get, you know, your fingerprints and oils on them. I'd recommend cleaning them with IPA if you're not wearing gloves, right? Just making sure that you don't get those oily fingerprints, you don't have any dust or dirt on them. And, you know, it does help with adhesion as well, right? Like if a clean bottle will have better adhesion than a dirty bottle. So you should clean them before you do anything. You will have to use an adhesion promoter if you find some bottles if they're powder coated, have silicone in the powder coating, you may have to flame treat and use an adhesion promoter. Or if they're acrylic based bottles, you might have to find an adhesion promoter, but typically bottles and glassware is not made out of acrylic. So yes, you may have to use adhesion promoter. We found higher quality bottles, tumblers tend to have better quality powder coating.
Okay, so my mic. Yeah, so what we're doing here is, so from bottles, you can see all the different substrates that we print on here, wood, canvas, tile, aluminum, acrylic. So what we did from bottles to a flat print, we're actually printing, you can see the donor plaque, the black donor plaque there with that emblem in the center of it. This is actually going to require two passes because we're using the clear as a kind of to mimic the embossing in that image. So it actually shows through and it looks like an actual metal. So that's going to be your second pass. So you're going to print your textured first. And that's the texture is going to be obviously the texture in the background where it kind of looks like a stone. And then it's going to automatically come back and print that clear pass for you. So yeah. There is a setting on the control panel. It's an auto feed. You use that also for ADA signage. You press that. And again, it prints your base, comes back, and then prints your color. And then it will stop at the second pass.
Yeah. So basically, if you're doing ADA or textured like this, it would, like Steve said, it feeds it through and then it goes back to zero and then it feeds it back through to print again. So you don't have to do it. It does that because it's printing in line, right? And there's only so many nozzles to go around when you're building texture that you can't print the clear at the same time. So that's why it does it twice. So basically when it comes out now, it'll have everything but that medallion in the middle and the raised font. And the second time it'll put it down. I've been at trade shows and printed similar signs to this, and people ask if it's been embossed, right? Like if it's been stamped. But the answer is no, it's just clear ink. The clear ink actually allows the light to pass through it, reflect off the metal, and then pounce back out. And it provides provides eye-catching, details to the sign. Like it just looks that much better than if you were to print flat varnish. So, and what he's doing right now, I mean, it's texture, yes, but it's the same thing as printing a flat signage or a promotional item like USB drives or cell phones. You basically just send your file over and it'll just print them. So you can see we've got a number of items on the table, textured signs, there's a cell phone case to the left side, ADA signs, there's an acrylic plaque there with the firefighter on it. All those can be printed on this second surface. Like on that acrylic, you just flip it over when you're done.
And just to get a sense of how the file looks here, I went through this yesterday, but basically we have our background here that we created. We have our texture layer, which is going to be in the center, and then our clear layer, which is going to be in the front. It's going to be the front layer. So you basically put those all together. All right. And pretty simple. Obviously, we're printing one here, but you'd either array them on the 12 by 24 print area and just basically hit file, send to rip, and there's a textured queue that you send it to. And then in that textured queue, you have, I believe, four different print modes, which are obviously more height. So we have a textured low to texture maximum. So it kind of gives you the ability to show your customer, you know, how much ink you lay down and how you could replicate that memorial plaque.
Yeah, and I did talk to a customer yesterday that told me that he actually did his first one of these for somebody that needed a donation plaque, and they were having a ceremony and it was kind of short notice, and he was able to print it out, and he said he was able to charge an arm and a leg for it, but it was still cheaper than doing a cast plaque, and they could get it, you know, the next day. So they are very profitable when you can find them. But also these donor memorial plaques, you got to open your eyes for them because they are everywhere. They're often overlooked. If you watch any of the other ones about printing Focast plaques, I mean, they're in every school, library, I mean, municipality, just like ADA signs. They're cast, donation plaques, memorial plaques everywhere, especially hospitals, schools. So if you can offer another solution that may not be as expensive as cast or has a faster turnaround, you know, start letting your customers know we can do these faux cast plaques for you. You know, it could be a nice margin business for you, considering, you know, the amount of ink that's on that sign and the cost of the material, and maybe even, you know, a nice finished wood plaque to mount it to is not all that much. And again, if you have any questions, feel free to use the question answer feature or use the chat function. So the 1800, as we've talked about, uses those Epson heads. As for maintenance for the machine, we do recommend, you know, you replace that head about once a year. We do find that the more you use it and clean it, if you clean the head and the capping station every day, it will last longer. But typically about a year, you can get over a year. I've had quite a few customers tell me that. Capping station should get replaced about every 3-4 months. Again, if you're using it every day and you're cleaning it, it does last longer.
And go ahead.
I was going to say, and this system does have white ink in it. It's got cyan, magenta, yellow, black, white varnish or clear. You know, you want to, if you've got white ink in a print system, you just want to make sure you're using it, cleaning it. You know, if you're not going to use it for, you know, a couple of weeks, you want to make sure you're going in there and printing out a couple white color blocks every couple of days or so, just to keep that white ink moving.
I was going to say, so what it's doing is printing that second pass of clear. So obviously you saw that it went back automatically and sent that second pass. You could actually have it pre-process, and as soon as that in the queue, and as soon as that first job is done, it automatically goes to the second job and prints. So you don't have to actually go walk to the laptop or computer and wait and hit print. So it's pretty convenient.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Got a couple questions here. What sizes can you print with the smaller format and the mid format? Well, this machine is 12 inches by 24. And that's 12 inches, 24 inches long, so 1x2. And like I said, this one's got 6 inches of print height. The S35 has 15 inches of print height. The UV53 is the next step up. That one's 5 feet by 3 feet. And then the UV84 is 8x4, so 8 feet by 4 feet. And we have a question about the electrical, what's needed. Funny enough, this just needs a 110 outlet, just one, that's it. And that will run the entire printer. It's a very low draw print system. I mean, I've got some customers that have these, you know, bolted down to tables inside of trailers, and they hook them up to a generator when they go to like music and art festivals, and they will literally sit there and print items all day long for people, and you know, charge them through you know, their iPad or their phone. So they are portable. They weigh about 250 pounds, so two people can move them. And they do travel, because like I said, I've got customers that use them in trailers, vans. Our technical salespeople also do demos. They'll take these printers, they'll put them in the back of their SUVs, they'll drive them to customer sites, you know, pull them out of their van, their car, go plug it into the wall and do a demo right there. So if you are looking for a demo like that, just let us know. We can make arrangements with the local technical sales specialist. But these printers actually travel pretty well, and they only require a 110.
So this one's almost done.
This one is almost done.
And then from there, we're just going to jump to the t-shirt. I'm just going to do a quick white t-shirt. This is actually done on our flexible ink. So we have two different versions. We have the IR2 and the F6T, which is the flexible.
Mm-hmm. Yep. So basically, when you get the printer, you would decide if you want the rigid ink or if you want the flexible ink. The flexible ink is just as good as the rigid ink. The rigid ink's older. It was the first generation. Then we came out with the flexible. The big difference is that the rigid ink, you can do clear Braille dots when you're doing ADA signs. The flexible ink, you cannot do the clear Braille dots on those signs. So if you look at that sign right there, that is clear ink printed onto Inkmark aluminum. It's like a brass gold color. It is pre-coated with a primer, so you just peel off the film and print. But as Steve showed us right there, that it looks embossed, right? And that's just the clear ink.
There's just another example of the...
Yep. Okay. We got a cost just about maintenance here, Steve. So I'm just going to go through that real quick.
Yeah, I'm just going to jump on the other one.
Okay. So, you're looking at maintenance costs, the capping station, the print head. The print head is, I think, around $2,500 to replace. Again, you can get a year or more out of it. And the good thing about it is when you do replace it, you actually end up replacing all the colors because the print head's one full unit of eight colors, eight channels. So you basically get a new print head. It's like printing when it was brand new. So you get cyan, magenta, yellow, black, two channels of white, and two channels of clear. So, and then, you know, you have the capping stations. Those get replaced as well. Other than that, you're just kind of using lint-free wipes and some flush to kind of clean up the ink, partially cured ink, the overspray, all of that kind of builds up around the bottom of the faceplate of the printhead and around the edges of the printhead and also around the wiper on the capping station, because you don't want to start smearing partially cured ink across the faceplate and clogging nozzles. And we do have a variable dial on there, so you can increase and decrease the UV light power. It goes from basically 1 to 11, 11 being more than 10, so it's more powerful. And
crank it up to 11.
Yeah. And so basically you can kind of tone it down from where you need it. If you do print at 11, this is with any UV LED printer. Just go ahead, do a cleaning after you're done printing, because you want to get any light, any ink that's been exposed to stray light out of the nozzle so that it doesn't start to cure backwards through the head. Right? It'll help you. And we do have a question just about learning how to use software for people who are newer to it. We have videos on YouTube that are available anytime. These videos that we're doing here, we have a whole bunch from ones we've done in the past. They're on the website under the Printovation Expo. Click it and it kind of just has them all organized for you. We try to do some software training in these as well to try to showcase how the software works. And then we do have under the support tab a tech support portal where, you know, the color byte manual is at, the best practices guide, you know, stuff like that for the software. So if you click on color byte, it'll bring you into the software portion of the tech support portal.
Thank you. So what I did is what we have here is our F6 machine. We have it set up to print white shirt. We actually use a platen. It's a 12 by 18 platen that we kind of set the shirt in.
The shirt looks black, but I know it's just the shadows. Yeah, it's just the shadows. So I was going to say, we have, I'm just going to answer a question real quick.
Yeah.
If you want to get that going. We have someone here said they watched the video on the 1800 maintenance and it has 1 day, 1 week, 1 month required maintenance. And does that apply to the newer 1800S? And that's yes. Every printer, every inkjet printer out there will have a daily maintenance. It will have a weekly maintenance, a monthly, a 6 month, and a 1 year maintenance. It's just, it's a lot like a car, right? Hey, I gotta get my oil changed. I gotta replace the air filter. I gotta get the radiator, you know, flushed out. It's the same thing. Typically the daily maintenance is doing a head cleaning and just cleaning up any partially cured ink around the capping station print head. Nothing that takes a lot of time. The head cleaning and nozzle check are in the software. You just basically click a button and then run a nozzle test. You know, you have to clean the encoder that's in there. The encoder tells the print head where it is. There's something like 10,000 tick marks in every inch. So it knows where it is at all times. You have to clean that with some IPA and a lint-free wipe. It gets dust on it over time. It gets overspray on it over time, and that can stop the encoder from actually reading it. You know, cleaning the dust off the rails and oiling the rails. Again, you're just getting the dust off so that the bearings can move smoothly without any hindrance. And every, you know, if you're looking into printers, you should always ask before you buy it, you know, if you can see the printer maintenance log, right? They should always have a PM schedule, printer maintenance schedule of when things are due and whatnot. And that'll give you an idea of, okay, well, at 6 months, I got to replace the ink filters, or at, you know, 1 year, I've got to replace this part. And it'll give you an idea of ongoing ink, you know, maintenance costs and whatnot. So we're printing a t-shirt right now. With the t-shirts, you know, there's a few things we have to do. If we're printing to a white t-shirt, you can literally just load the t-shirt in and print to it. And that goes for cotton, cotton blends and polyesters. You know, think of your like Nike dry fits, Climacool by Adidas, stuff like that. You know, your polyester polos and stuff. You basically, if it's white, you can print right to it. You take it off the printer like just now and put it into that heat press, clamshell heat press. You'd press it for a few minutes at, I think, like 315. Yep. And what that does is it basically helps set the image and it helps to make sure all the ink's fully cured. After that, you can throw it into a, you know, bag, box, and ship it. Now, when we're printing to something that you want to put white under, so if you're printing to like a gray or black t-shirt and you want to have bright, vibrant colors, you need to pre-treat the shirt. Now, our pre-treatment's a little different than other pre-treatments. Our pre-treatment is literally just distilled water. It's just water. We're getting the shirt wet, right? We don't want to be like sopping wet, just came out of the washer, but we want it to be fairly wet, you know, damp, not just a little bit of mist. And what that does is when we print the white, because this water in the ink is made from petroleum, it basically makes the white ink sit above the threads instead of soaking into them. And if you print without the water, what you'll get is basically a muted white. And you go to print to it, it's not going to be very bright, very vibrant colors. So we just recommend, hey, get the shirt wet. You can use a spray bottle and then put it on there and print the white. And then it's going to go back after it prints the white, because you have to use the full width of the head to get a very nice opaque white. And then it's going to go back and print the color. So it's a two-step process. But like if you're going to just print black to a yellow shirt like up on the wall, you know, you can just print to that. You don't need to pre-treat it. It's only when you're going to do a white underbase. And with that, it's...
That took about a minute.
Yep. I was going to say, it does very well on polyesters, right? The hand on the polyesters is thinner than the hand on the cottons. The cottons feel a little thicker with the ink, but basically you can stretch it, wear it out.
This is white, but
yeah,
This is an example of a white. Obviously, it's a little thicker because you're trying to get that opacity, but.
Yeah. On polyesters, we get about 70, 75 washes before it deteriorates. And then on cottons, we're getting about 35 washes. And again, you can print to, cotton blends, tri blends, and stuff like that as well. There's polyester Nike dry fit.
Nike dry fit, yeah.
Yep. No white background. You're just printing right to it and then just putting it in the heat press.
Yeah, and then that's.
Question about can flexible and rigid inks be used in the same printer? Unfortunately, no. What we found is when we've tried to flush out the rigid ink from the flush and vice versa, is that over time the chemicals actually leach into the ink lines and they leach into the plastics of the ink tanks and the plastics of the dampers and the epoxies and glues in the print head. And even if you flush them out and then put ink in and run, over time, you're going to end up getting problems. And basically, you're going to end up getting clogged nozzles, clogged heads. You'll end up getting some failure in the ink lines because they're basically kind of dissolving because the chemicals don't really like each other. So we have tried. But ultimately, it's kind of you gotta pick when you buy the machine, and what you pick is what you get. To change it out, you'd have to change out all the ink tanks, ink lines, the dampers, print head, anything the ink touches, basically, which would be a little expensive, to be honest. Again, if you have any questions, feel free to use that Q&A feature. So you do not have to change inks between printing t-shirts and acrylic or vice versa. So if you've got the flexible ink and you want to print a shirt, you could then, once you're done, you could print to an acrylic sign. You could do an ADA sign. You could do, whatever. You don't need to switch inks. The IR2 rigid ink has that can do that clear Braille on ADA signs. So if that's important to you, then you would want to do that. But in terms of adhesion, abrasion, stuff like that, they're relatively pretty similar. There's not much of a difference between them, the IR2 and the IRF6 flexible ink. All right, so what we can do is we can go back to the presentation, just kind of show you what we printed here, ink times, and whatnot, and we'll continue to field questions. So if you have them, let us know, put them out there, and we'll answer the questions the best that we can.
And what I'm doing is just doing that one last ADA sign.
Oh, you're doing an ADA sign?
Yeah, why not?
Okay. All right, so we got another couple questions here. So if we want to do ADA and t-shirts, would we have to change the inks on the 1800S? Is that correct? No, you can still do ADA. You just, if you are doing shirts, you have the flexible ink. You just can't do clear Braille.
No, so you can only do
clear Braille. Sorry, yes, yep. You can only do clear Braille. My fault. You can only do clear Braille on the flexible ink ones. So you can do ADA, you can do textured, you can do bottles, you can do t-shirts with the flexible. The IR2, you can do all the same stuff, but not the t-shirts. And you can do colored Braille. Thanks for that catch, Steve.
Yeah, no worries. You saved me all the time.
And then just a question about what's the right amount of water on the material. I mean, it's got to be pretty damp, not just a slight mist. It's got to be to the point where it's not soaking wet, but almost soaking wet. And then if it's cotton, if it's 100% cotton, you should really try to use like a piece of metal or acrylic and just kind of lay the sign, the fibers in the same direction If you ever look at cotton fibers versus polyester under a microscope, polyester is very neat, very uniform. All the fibers go the same way. When you look at 100% cotton under a microscope, it looks like a cactus. There's fibers all over the place. There's no real direction or uniform. So when you're praying to cotton, instead of, you know, just praying to it, you know, that could cause some roughness in a print. You would want to just kind of take like a like I said, a piece of acrylic or metal and just kind of pull the fibers in one direction. And that should make it smooth out and make sure everything feels the same.
And what I did, I just zoomed up a little bit so you can see that base.
Yep.
And it's down, printing. So
yep.
You can see printing. That it's printing the clear and the white, actually the CMYK and then white to build that height.
Yeah. There is a question here about, can you see how many cc's of ink a job uses? So we don't use cc's, we use milliliters. And yes, there is, it's in the job. So maybe we could have Steve show us that.
Yep.
In the software, but basically you have to rip the job and there is a rip only feature. So you don't send it to the printer. And it will give you the cost in the amount of ink that you're using. And it will tell you how much clear, how much cyan, how much magenta, yellow, black, white, and then give you that cost. And you can manipulate that cost any way you want, but it's usually done, put in the liter cost.
So as Adam said, you just gotta hit rip only.
Yep, so it's going to rip the graphic.
And then once it rips, this is enabled here, so. Sorry, it's taking a little bit. Got a couple things running here. So it shows you, as Adam said, the ink amount usage.
On that image there, we use 0.0000563 of a liter of ink, or 2.82 cents. And then you can see down at the bottom, it says, hey, it's 23.4 cents.
Yep. So you could also include your material costs and things like that, so.
Yep. So now you can see it's printing the colors over the top, printing the background. Good questions today, though. They're all pretty good. But you can use these machines to print to a lot of different things. And we do have bushings in the table so you can create jigs. So if you have a laser, you know, like an epilogue or something like that, you could create your own jigs. So if you're printing USB drives for somebody, you could go ahead and cut out from a thickness that's relatively the same as the USB drive, have acrylic, and you could laser it out and then glue some posts onto the bottom and you could sit it into those bushings. And that way you can print to the same spot every time. Like there's a jig for golf balls.
Golf ball, yeah. Maybe I can see the detail in this golf ball. It's
too close. Oh, really there we good. Go.
Look at that.
Yep. And no, DCS does not actually own a golf club.
I even put DCS on the golf ball. On the golf ball.
Yeah.
So it's pretty high quality.
Yeah. Yeah, it's high quality for that one shot before it goes into the woods.
Yeah.
Well, you want to show us that sign real quick?
Yep. So here you go. So obviously I didn't cut the piece right, but there you go. Then you could obviously shear it afterwards, but
yeah, you could shear it down and cut those pieces off.
This is a 6x4 sign.
So printers are pretty versatile. We're going to just switch over here and just finish up the presentation, finish answering anyone's questions, and we'll take it from there. So we printed this bottle today, and this bottle is 25 cents worth of ink, right? I think we said 24 or something. And it took 2 minutes and 25 seconds to print that. So with that, you can figure out, okay, well, it's not a huge bottle, but it gives me something to go off of for how long it's going to take to print. Again, when it's done, you just pull out the easy seal, put a new bottle on, put it back in, and click print again. So the reload time is not that long either. And then the t-shirt, the ink cost on this shirt that Steve printed was 85 cents and took a minute. And that's to a, I believe that's a tri-blend or a full cotton shirt. And then we've got a question here about overspray. If you're printing edge to edge, you can print edge to edge, right? The only time overspray is going to be an issue is if you have something that's pretty thick, you know, that has a little bit of height to it, and you're printing all the way, because you'll get overspray on the edges of the side of the sign. And if that's the case, if you're doing a full bleed like that, edge-to-edge printing, when you're done, you just want to kind of clean up the print head afterwards, because overspray can basically go back up onto the faceplate, and it can cause basically clogging of the nozzles. So you, after you're done printing, if you're printing to like a 1-inch piece of acrylic and you're doing an edge to edge, you may just want to do a quick cleaning afterwards. And it only uses, I think, about 3 mils of ink to do a cleaning. So it's not like it's a lot of ink out of 6 colors. So, but so the shirt was 85 cents, took a minute. The bottle is 25 cents and took 2 minutes, 25 seconds. And again, that's because we're only using a small portion of the print head when we're printing, right? We basically turn off, you know, part of the front, part of the back, and we use the middle to print where it's closest to the bottle as it's rotating. So that took, that's why that takes a little longer. We do have an Easy Seal Slim adapter, which allows you to print on things like drumsticks, you know, pens, pencils, stuff like that. Again, and we do that, it limits the number of nozzles you can use again. We got a question about what substrates can you print on for ADA signs. And I'm just gonna kind of go through them all a little bit. So if you're doing ADA, most ADA signs, you know, are recommended to be P95 acrylic, frosted acrylic. You're gonna wanna use the adhesion promoter on that before you print. You know, we're printing to ink mark metal for most of our signs and samples, because it's something we have a good supply of. It's cheaper than acrylic. And it's also thinner, lighter weight, isn't as bulky. you know, you can print to wood, you can print to metals. So the only metals that you should stay away from if you're doing ADA would be like the laminated metals, kind of like chem metal and Wilson art. We're gonna do an ink adhesion and substrate editorial tomorrow, or educational seminar tomorrow. I'd recommend you join that, because we'll talk about a bunch of different stuff, and that's meant to be more educational. For bottles, you know, we can print to the different types like Polar and Yeti, Orca, with powder coating. You know, you use an adhesion promoter. If it's the bare aluminum, you know, we recommend adhesion promoter, maybe a flame treatment with it, and you get really good scratch resistance. If you want to print cylindrically to glassware, to something that, you know, you want to make sure it's dishwasher safe kind of deal, you have to use a flame treatment called pyrosil, which basically deposits a chemical onto the glass, onto the metal, a wipe-on adhesion promoter. You print to it, and then you have dishwasher safe glassware, you know. And I've used it in the past, and it's worked great. So I'd recommend that if you're looking into doing cylindrical and glassware. t-shirts, cotton, cotton blends, polyesters. Those are pretty much the generic stuff there. There's not much else to talk about for those. Question about how the flame treatment is done. It's literally like a blowtorch. You got a metal canister, aerosol canister, and you got a glass aerosol canister. You pick the one you're doing, which with a lever, and it just turns on that canister, the other one. You open the nozzle, you hold a lighter up to it, and it turns on. And then you basically just do a quick flame wash up and down with the wand, and it deposits the chemicals into the print area. And then you turn it off, wipe it with your adhesion promoter, and print. It does wear off after about 24 hours. So what you want to do is you do want to basically do this flame wash, do this pyrosyl flame treatment right when you're printing. So, you know, you could do a dozen, then go print them, but I wouldn't want to, you know, do 18 dozen of them and let them sit there overnight. It'd be a waste. The other thing you can use too is if you're printing to plastics, you can use a propane torch from like Home Depot, you know, Lowe's, Menards, local hardware store. There are these Burns-O-Matic automatic torches, and you can buy the blue propane cylinders. And again, a flame wash is just something you're just quickly going back and forth really quick. You're not cooking it. You're not trying to melt it. You're just trying to get the surface of the material really excited so that it is more receptive to ink. And I find that propane works better on plastics, you know, your acrylics, polycarbs, lexans, all that stuff, you know, coroplast. And that MAP gas, which is a yellow canister, it's got chemicals in it too, which help evaporate water. Those seem to work better for printing to metal. So yellow canister for metal, quick flame wash, adhesion promoter, print, plastics, use the propane torch, and then adhesion promoter and print. And you don't have to do that with everything. Like acrylics, you could just use the wipe on adhesion promoter. But if you find you're having trouble with something and it's not quite working, using a flame treatment can really help. We have a question about from Paul about, could you use a heat gun? So on plastic, yes, you could use a heat gun because it's all about the heat. It's just trying to get it heated up a little bit to increase the surface tension. So you could use a heat gun. I prefer propane. I don't know why. I just think it works a little better than a heat gun, but you can use a heat gun on that. But it won't do anything for metal. The chemicals in the MAP gas help with the adhesion. So, but on plastics, you could use a heat gun.
Save some for tomorrow, Adam.
It's all a repeat. So if you have any other questions, let us know, but we're pretty much come to the end of it here. So if you guys have any, you know, samples, custom samples, you want to see a personalized demo with your products or whatnot, you know, feel free to reach out to us. You can reach out to us through the website. You can reach out through us through email at info@directcolorsystems.com, or you can email me at adam.torville@ directcolorsystems.com. So question here, just about helpful hints on praying to golf balls. So there's a few things we'll talk about here is that you do want to make sure your jig is set up properly, to hold the balls, because that jig Steve showed you earlier, there's a second piece that goes over the top to help, with stray light, because you're printing so high off the ball, you don't want the stray light to cure and flash your print head. So if you're printing to something like that, you'd want to do a cleaning right after you're done printing. And then, if you're printing to golf balls, again, using a propane torch or heat gun, an adhesion promoter, and then printing to them, that would work best. And that you could just print to them regularly if the balls aren't going to be used for much. But the top coating of those balls is a urethane coating that is meant to, you know, resist scuff marks and stuff like that, because you're hitting those golf balls at a tremendous speed, with the, you know, a driver club. and you know, they've got grooves in them. Also, they're going to hit the ground. So they try to put in stuff into that top coat to make it so it doesn't get scuffed and dirty too easily. Also, when that ball gets hit, it goes from being round to being oval shaped. So it does stretch out the ink. And, you know, if you're using the rigid ink, it is probably fine. If you're using the flexible ink, it would be fine, but I'd recommend the heat and then probably using a little bit of adhesion promoter on there. And with our adhesion promoter, you know, you're gonna take the bottle that you get or from us, and you're gonna cut that with 70% IPA and then 30% of the adhesion promoter. And that's what we'd recommend. Can you print on solo cups or would the ink crack? I'd recommend if you're gonna print to a solo cup, you'd print it with the flexible ink. Obviously those are not permanent anyways, so depending upon how much someone wants to pay for that, but I'd use the flexible ink. If you use the rigid ink, it would crack. Those are very thin plastic cups. So if we don't have any other questions, we'll call this day. And what we'll do is we'll put this video up on the website. It'll also be on YouTube, and it'll be there to be viewed at any time. And if you have any questions, again, let Steve or I know. You can contact us through the website, through the info at Direct Color Systems, or adam.torville at Direct Color Systems. And again, samples, custom demos. Just let us know if you need any of that stuff.
Or steve.dvorak at Direct Color.
And the videos will be on the website, directcolorsystems.com, under the Printovation banner. And there'll be, you know, links there to other previous Printovation demos that we've done. All right. Well, thank you, everybody. Hope you all have a great day.
Thank you. Take care.
Thank you.